I'd like to start the talk with a prologue, not really an introduction. Most of you know about Star Trek. For me and for my peers, Star Trek has been such an innovation warehouse. A lot of things happening in Star Trek became reality. As Steve Jobs says, innovation is the ability to see changes as opportunity, not as a threat. You all agree there are changes, and we have seen the changes for last year or so. Before pandemic, our life was very different. Our life was a lot more face-to-face physical interactions. Where are we now? We are much more virtually connected. We meet online, we work online, we learn online. Rather than physical distancing, virtual connectedness is really in the main agenda for all of us. This is possible because technology adaptation is happening much more rapidly than we ever imagined, because we are forced in this situation. We use the technology not only for entertainment, we use our technology to connect our life to yours and our life to outside the world. McKinsey claims that digitally enabled productivity gains accelerate the fourth industrial revolution, and time is now. The inflection point is now, and I truly believe semiconductor industry can play a humongous role in that area. Among that, the metaverse. It's such excitement time, right? It's such exciting type topic for everybody. Everybody talk about metaverse. It started from the book science fiction, Snow Crash, to movie. Now, it actually is basically center of the entertainment. Travis Scott has about 10 million audience. This is a humongous success for the entertainment industry, unknown territory. Not only that, Facebook, Microsoft, and Nvidia all talk about metaverse. Metaverse is here. Virtual reality to lead virtual life is right now here. Is it true? Are we really there yet? I think, to be honest with you, metaverse, enabling metaverse is a lot more complicated than just making games. Why is that? Because we like a best experience. We like our virtual life to be our virtual real life. Feels like real life. In order to do that, what you need is your AR, VR glasses to your user experience from the cloud data processing. There is a seamless data transfer and seamless actual experience you need to have between the user and computing system, with a lot of different stacks of computing stacks, with the edge devices, edge cloud, and cloud that works seamlessly. Fast communication, fast chips, fast memory, more memory, and lower power. All of these actually are needed. What does that mean? That means technology is pushed toward extreme. We are going extremely fast technology trend. And that's an exciting time. What I'm going to show you is the compute demand. So we talked about fast chips and fast memory and fast technologies. Let's step back a little bit what the historical trend is. What you are seeing here is a mobile processor. X-axis is a chip area, how small you can make a chip, versus Y-axis is the number of transistors you packed in a small area, density. So the more density you put, the more functions you can put. The trend is continuing. The die area is small. However, you want actually a much more device density there. So more transistors packed, much more small area. So technology scaling is really, really, this is a bread and butter of semiconductor technology, and that's continuing, and the demand is not slowing down. More than ever, AI application, your face recognition, recommendations, on all of this, you basically are requiring the semiconductor technology to be extreme. What you are actually seeing here, the ear versus AI model parameter count. what is the AI model parameter count? That's basically how accurately or how complicated things you can actually predict. So it's same as a similar, it's not exactly the same, but it's similar as a memory usage or compute. The blue line is the trend. AI model parameters per year is going to about 240 per 2 years. While Moore's law says about 2x per 2 years. What a gap. This gap is actually really demands that we gotta go faster than Moore's law. Moore's law has been serving us so great for the last few decades. Now, our application, our spaces, we are demanding the technology to go faster. So logic took the opportunity. TSMC and Samsung, the logic foundry took the opportunity and moved forward. It's an opportunity as well as challenge. What you're actually seeing here is TSMC ISSCC 2021 scaling roadmap. Very similar to Samsung as well. What the claim is that using new materials, which can actually replace silicon or augment silicon performance, and using new device architecture, put a lot more transistors in a smaller footprint, smaller area, by stacking up either FinFET or nanosheet, or stacking the devices really 3D dimension, you can actually continue the scaling. This is coming and between 3 nanometers and 2 nanometers, and TSMC and Samsung, Intel, they all aligned up to nanosheet. Beyond nanosheet is open, to be honest with you. So it's still exploratory, and we are still going through the exploratory topics. Are we different for memory? Not really. Memory is scaling as well, and it continues. But there are enough of challenges, right? There are certain things you cannot change. Day has 24 hours. We all have 24 hours. You cannot go smaller than atomic scale. So how much you can scale in 2D, which is the atomic scale limited? So how are we going to scale? That's going to be the interesting question. So far, about 25% every year, the density growth, and now about 5x increase for the last 12 years, next 12 years. And that's the journey we got to continue, and we will continue. And this is a journey we know we must walk. Question is that enough? I started a talk with the faster than Moore's law. So question is that enough following the way we have done before? Let me give you an example. NFT, I think NFT everybody knows, the metaverse, it's a topic of metaverse as well, right? It's non-fungible tokens for digital asset. You have a virtual world, of course, you have a virtual asset. So this is the digital art from unknown artist. What you're actually seeing here is the day off. Are you taking a good day off today? Enjoying a lot of different discussions? So it's a digital art and you want to actually minting it. What does that mean? You do NFT. NFT is basically blockchain technology that certifies a digital asset to be unique and not interchangeable so that you can protect and you can make a transaction. So there is a virtual transaction with a cryptocurrency or bitcoins. When you do a virtual the cryptocurrency trade, you pay a price for gas fee. What an appropriate word on this. Why is that? Because Bitcoin consumes a lot of compute power. It's very known. Mining a coin actually it's a very compute intensive workload. So it consumes a lot of power. How much does it consume? Let me give you some number. About 110 terawatts hour per year. Number is too big. I don't know what that means, right? The number means about 0.55% of global electric consumption. About 20% of the South Korean electric consumption. Bitcoin industry consumes that much of electricity. Of course, not everything is actually have a carbon footprint. I'd like to introduce just a two trend a little bit on the topic. One is basically the high capacity two-tier memory. As I mentioned, convergence error, introducing much more different memory styles, you can actually help the power efficiency. Storage collapse memory is actually introduced. Industry is adopting it. Still, it's not quite there yet. It's still emerging part of it. Using the much more like a memory, like a DRAM, but much higher capacity. It's an application that's called the managed DRAM solutions. Or much more like a storage, it's a persistent, but at the same time, much better latency than SSD or endurance. So that's the phase change memory. There are a lot more examples a lot of people are looking into, but this is the first step because this does not disturb our ecosystem drastically, but we can make a much more efficient computing using this high-performance, high-capacity second-tier memory. One step further, you probably remember Sedol Lee and AlphaGo 2016 Go competition. Of course, AlphaGo won at the expense of about 8700 power consumption because it's basically one person versus cloud. So power consumption is the question. Can we improve the power efficiency? Let me go back what I discussed. About 63% is the data transfer. The energy is consumed, the data transfer between compute and memory. If you don't move the data, unless it's absolutely needed, that will be cool. That will be saving a lot of energy. And you can store as much data as a small footprint. So you don't increase area, you just store more data in the same area. That will be cool. Another one is a store and compute simultaneously. As we talked about brain-like computing, this can be possible. This is still very, very premature area, an emerging area. Using non-volatile memory and multi-way cells and cross-point architectures, you can actually do certain computation using these architectures much more efficiently. And this is not just for academia. A lot of industries and startups are looking into that. That's called analog in-memory compute. You probably hear that. Sometimes it's called in-memory compute. So conventionally, you're using compute and memory. And for a lot of AI application, AI model that actually uses deep neural network training models. So what that is actually is very simple. It's basically the matrix vector multiplication. And cross-point architecture, you can do that much more easily using the resistive synaptic cells, resistive memory, and cross-point architecture, and summate with cross-point architecture, you can actually create for AI DNN application much more efficiently. Of course, it's application specific. I'm very generalizing this, but it's not really generalized. Still, this is an emerging area. A lot of academia are looking into it. A lot of companies are looking into it. We gotta look into it. Yes, this is not big business you can invest next 2 years. Probably next 10 years, it's going to tell us whether this is a successful area or not. But we gotta continue to do this journey to energy efficient computing. I only talk about the element. How does it work with the combining to the system? 3D integration is key. 3D integration is putting puzzle together, each Lego pieces, much more efficient ways to do so. A lot of people talk about, TSMC talk about that, AMD talk about that, Intel talked about that. This is not a new topic. Now time is here and everybody is doing it. Using different techniques of different pitch or different bandwidth, you can actually do 3D systems, chip-to-chip scaling, like DRAM to logic to get better power efficiency and performance. Or 2D SoC, which is much, much bigger, SoC to be disintegrated. You can make a smaller SoC with a much more complicated functionality. You can do that. Or as the logic scaling shows, you can stack two devices to make a much more area efficient, right? You cannot use a 2D anymore. You gotta go up and expand. And that's the concept of a journey toward beyond nano. It's not about making smaller and smaller devices. How to make a smaller devices in a much more smart way. And that's really the fight and challenges we gotta continue. Not only that, I only talked about device architecture materials because that's my background. I'm a semiconductor technologist. I have been live and breathe on this, and this is my, it's in my heart. So that's important. But unfortunately, the time is here. Itself, technology itself is not sufficient. We need to put them together in the system by heterogeneous integration, using 3D integration. And you need to use this one in heterogeneous computing, which means multiprocessors, like graphic processors or central processor or AI accelerators. All of this need to work seamlessly in a computing. And that's the era we gotta go. And that's the only way we can enable journey toward beyond nano. And I'm actually very positive that we are getting there. Let me end my talk with the epilogue. For me, going beyond nano is not just a journey of technology, it's a journey of energy efficient computing that involves everybody in semiconductor industry, not only the manufacturer or foundries. It needs to be our suppliers, material supplies, and EDAs, as well as actually the system companies. And energy efficient computing is really not simple. We gotta have a fundamental changes of our thinking. That means we need to look at the devices, materials, system in a very different ways. It's a long journey, as we all know, and the journey needs to start right now. Simply put, we cannot do all alone. We gotta do it together. Cultivating open and collaborative, open research cultures is going to be vital to success, and that's the way we gotta go. The technology doesn't have a boundaries. Technology doesn't have a borders. We gotta actually go beyond where we can see. To end my talk, I hope that actually you enjoyed the journey beyond nano, and I'm actually hope that you can feel something in excitement and actually join the journey together. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge my colleagues to make this presentation possible. So thank you so much for your attention. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks.